मैं डॉक्टर मिसुला हूँ। वी आर डिस्कसिंग हेपेटाइटिस हेपेटोलॉजी। होप दैट नेक्स्ट वीक दिस विल बी लेक्चर्ड बी इन द यूनिवर्सिटी एंड माय बेस्ट टू ऑल ऑफ यू व्हेन यू आर कमिंग टू यूनिवर्सिटी गेट वैक्सीनेटेड एंड वैक्सीनेशन सेंटर द पीपल्स मेडिकल यूनिवर्सिटी इज एस्टैब्लिश्ड एट द फ्रंट ऑफ मेन गेट सो प्लीज गेट वैक्सीनेटेड and it is mandatory. If any student got for this, we can positive again, we may suffer from the problem and we may go to the university. So please, whenever, anytime if any, when you report to the university, get yourself vaccinated in front of the main gate at visitors and at the established vaccination center for students and employees of the university. So we are discussing hepatology. We have discussed hepatitis B, C, D, and acute hepatitis. Now is the term for the chronic liver disease. In our country, in West and poor countries, the common cause of the chronic liver disease and its consequences are usually viral diseases, hepatitis B, C, and Delta viruses. But there's another cause. There's also among the common causes for chronic liver disease, and it's very common in Western world, in developed countries. Because we are receiving more infectious agents here and we are getting more cases of the chronic liver disease due to viruses rather than infecting agents. But in developed countries, developed world, there are some other causes of chronic liver disease that we will discuss here. But these causes are also not uncommon in our country as well. So non-alcoholic fatty liver disease. Non-alcoholic fatty liver disease and NASH, it means when we are labeling it, a topic of non-alcoholic fatty liver disease, it means alcohol is also a causative agent to cause liver disease. So at the end of this topic, we will share a few slides about the alcoholic liver disease as well. So it's a related topic. You look at the liver, the normal liver, there's a red, brown, smooth and regular margins. If you will look at the your right side, a cirrhotic liver, it's an irregular, nodular, and fatty nodular deposition over in the liver that we are detected on the ultrasonography or other investigation that we will discuss. So this will be the picture of the liver when it gets when it's deposited by the fat. Common cause: obesity, overeating, fast foods. Of chronic non-alcoholic fatty liver disease. The most common cause of chronic liver disease in many countries, particularly in developed countries, as I we discussed earlier, it's a common cause. In our countries, the viruses may be the common cause, but in Western or developed countries, non-fatty liver disease, common cause, often detected on routine ultrasound examination. Sometimes people put some other problems or for the illness and when they are examined by ultrasonography or particularly make they have raised delay in liver function test when the ultrasound is done that showing fatty changes. Steatosis is found in up to 1/3 of these patients. Risk factors of non-alcoholic fatty liver disease that we usually say NAFL are obesity, hypertension, type 2 diabetes, and hyperlipidemia. These are risk factors for non-alcoholic fatty liver disease. It is also considered as a hepatic manifestation of metabolic syndrome. So, if you know about metabolic syndrome, so it's a hepatic manifestation of metabolic syndrome. And NAFLD ranges from fatty infiltration, when there's a fatty deposition in the liver, we label it as steatosis. It may range from the steatosis to fatty inflammation, infiltration with inflammation. When there's inflammation, there will be a label for any disorder, hepatitis. So hepatitis, there will be hepatitis. With non-alcoholic steatohepatitis, and commonly we say it's NASH. When there's inflammation, with fatty infiltration with inflammation, then it's labeled as NASH, and this NASH will progress to the fibrosis, cirrhosis, and the hepatocellular carcinoma, all the consequences of the liver, the chronic liver diseases, like for the viruses or metabolic disorders or alcohol, or same for the non-alcoholic liver disease. Liver-related adverse events between NASH and severe cirrhosis are almost the same. NAFLD is estimated to affect 20 to 30% of population in the Western countries and around 5 to 18% in Asians. About 1 in 10 cases of NAFLD develop NASH. So, pehle unko hepatitis nahi, inflammation nahi hota. Agar 1 in 10 patients will develop inflammation, then they are labeled as NASH, non-alcoholic steatohepatitis. It is estimated that NAFLD is present in 94% of the obese patients whose BMI is more than 30 kilograms per meter square surface area of the body, and 67% of the overweight with BMI more than 25 kg per meter square of the body, and 25% of the normal weight patients may develop NAFLD. So 25% of the normal weight patients are also at risk to develop NAFLD, non-alcoholic liver disease. Non-obese patients, particularly Asians, account for the 3 to 30% of the NAFLD cases. So NAFLD Asians may come. The prevalence of NAFLD among NAFLD Asians may normal weight or common. The prevalence of NAFLD among diabetic patients ranges from 40 to 70%. So diabetic patients may be go for the ultrasonography of diabetic type, particular type 2 diabetic patients, you will see the get the result of the ultrasonography with the fatty infiltration and sometimes inflammation as well, or fibrosis, etc. NAFLD is becoming the leading cause of liver dysfunction in non-alcoholic viral negative hepatitis population in Europe and North America, and may become the leading cause of liver transplantation in the next 5 years. So, the possibility of hepatitis B, C control in the next 5 years, may vaccination every year, globally, campaigns every year. Viral disorders, viral diseases come more to eliminate their diet, but possibly take us 5 years more than for other cases of chronic liver disease get NAFLD and alcoholic polymer. Frequency of steatosis varies with ethnicity. That's 33% among white and 24% in blacks. So white are more at risk to develop NAFLD. And there's also difference in the gender. 42% of the white males versus 24% of the white females are at risk to develop NAFLD. So white male are at more risk, and white male, and white overall white population is more risk than the black population. Only a few patients will progress to cirrhosis and end-stage liver disease. As obesity is common, so the cases of NAFLD are also rising. Old age, obesity, diabetes are risk factors for hepatic fibrosis and cirrhosis in these patients. Oral contraceptive pills increase the severity of NASH. Coffee consumption reduces the risk. So coffee here is helpful for these patients. Persons with NAFLD are at increased risk for cardiovascular diseases, chronic kidney diseases, and colorectal carcinomas. Other causes of NAFLD are steroids, somatoform, deltaism, tamoxifen, some drugs, Cushing syndrome, hypopituitarism, hypothyroidism, polycystic ovarian syndrome, hypobeta-lipoproteinemia, obstructive sleep apnea, usually these are obese, excessive dietary fructose, starvation, and the refeeding syndrome. These people are also the risk. Total power into the nutrition. These are the causes. One of the causes, though they are rare, cause for an effort, and some risk factors are psoriasis, soft drink consumption, and the cholecystectomy. So those who have gone for cholecystectomy, they are at risk to develop NAFLD, and those who are consuming soft drinks frequently, they are also at risk to develop NAFLD and NASH, and then fibrosis, cirrhosis, and the hepatocellular carcinoma, etc. All the consequences of the chronic liver disease. Pathogenesis of this disease: the imbalance between the rate of synthesis and catabolism of free fatty acids in the liver leads to the development of steatosis. Focal infiltration by polymorphonuclear neutrophils and the malaria macrovascular steatosis. Same as that for alcoholic hepatitis. So pathogen is almost same for alcoholic and non-alcoholic hepatitis. Oxidative stress injury and other factors lead to lipid peroxidation in the presence of fatty infiltration and inflammation. And all these things will lead to the fibrosis. And then fibrosis is enhanced by insulin resistance. So almost these obese patients are already insulin resistant, and they are again fibrosis is enhanced by the insulin resistance. But then this fibrosis will induce connective tissue growth factor. So again, this will worsen the fibrosis. Histology features are similar to alcohol-induced liver injury, range from simple fatty chain to fat inflammation. This label is NASH, then fibrosis, then cirrhosis. Clinical features are, most of the patients remain asymptomatic. And some people may live with upper quadrant pain or discomfort, heaviness. Hepatomegaly is found in 75% of the subjects. There may be subacute liver failure and signs of portal hypertension and advanced fibrosis may be seen in few cases. What would be the laboratory findings in these patients? In 80% of cases, laboratory values remain within normal limits. So you may get lab investigations for chronic liver disease or acute hepatitis that we had discussed in earlier lectures. LFT, prothrombin, like albumin, etc. You may get the normal, but sometimes you may get the abnormality in the following investigations, like mild elevation of the amino phosphate levels, and same for the alkaline phosphatase. Ratio of ALT to AST almost greater than 1 in FLD, but decreases to less than 1 in advanced fibrosis or cirrhosis, because when there's advanced fibrosis and cirrhosis, the hepatocytes will not be able to release more ALT, so AST will rise. As you know very well, we have discussed in previous lectures that AST is not only found by the hepatocytes but from other tissues of the body as well. So AST will rise, so that ALT and AST ratio will reverse when there are fibrosis or cirrhosis in these patients. ANA are smooth muscle antibodies, and a raised ferritin level may be found in 30% of the NASH. So ANA are smooth muscle antibodies, usually investigations for autoimmune hepatitis, but in this type of the disease, you may get in 30% of cases, you may get the ANA and anti-nuclear antibodies. Iron deficiency is common, particularly in females, obese patients, diabetic patients, blacks, and in patients with raised waist circumference. So, in this patient, you may get iron deficiency anemia as well. Diagnostic investigations is made by the ultrasound. Usually ultrasound is helpful, and it demonstrates steatosis in absence of other causes. So history is very important. If there is steatosis, we have to get that history properly from the patients, and particularly alcohol, because it is closely related to alcohol. So when alcohol history is negative and other viral markers are negative, you may label it as a case of the NASH. Ultrasound, CT scan, or MRI may show macrovascular steatosis. Liver biopsy is diagnostic but not routinely performed. It allows this staging of disease, standard approach to assess the extent of inflammation and fibrosis. So liver biopsy, but usually it's not needed. Liver biopsy should not be attempted in asymptomatic patients, and unsuspected steatosis is normal liver biochemistry. Elastography used to evaluate the degree of fibrosis, but may be technically difficult in morbid obesity. Elastography is a type of the again ultrasonography, so may be difficult because the magnetic waves may not cross the huge amount of the fatty deposition, and you may not get proper picture of the liver. How to manage? First of all, lifestyle modification. Along with lifestyle modification, avoidance of the offending factors that we discussed now. Weight loss, dietary fat or calorie restrictions. Losing the weight 0.5 to 1 kilogram per week until target weight is achieved. reduction of more than 79% of the body weight is associated with reduced steatosis, hepatocellular injury, and inflammation. Moderate exercise to reduce abdominal obesity. So abdominal obesity is very important, particularly in Asians. So though we are normal weight, but due to abdominal obesity and reverse hip waist ratio, we are at risk to develop steatosis. In the niche. Mediterranean diet reduces liver fat without losing weight. Vitamin E, 800 mg per day is also recommended, but it increases the risk of prostate cancer in male gender. Thiazolidinones are used for the diabetic patients. It reverses insulin resistance. Really, we prescribe this medication when there is insulin resistance there, and it's a common type of diabetes. So, is one of the options for these patients as well who are suffering from NAFLD or NASH. It improves amino transferase levels and histologic features of steatosis, but it will increase weight. So it's a side effect of thiazolidinones, so it increases the weight. Already most of these patients suffer from NAFLD, NASH or obese. Metformin reduces insulin resistance, improves amino transferase levels, but may not improve liver histology. Pentoxifilin improves liver biochemistry, but have high rate of these side effects. Also, deoxycholic acid may be effective when given in combination with our vitamin E. Early state, enteric lipase inhibitor causing malabsorption of the dietary fat can be given in those with BMR more than 30 kg per meter square surface area of the body. Those who lose body weight of more than 3% in 5% 3 months should continue on a state. Continuing 5% reduction, which are the 3 months, they can continue. They are not losing weight, then we need to continue this drug further. Bariatric surgery in patients with BMR more than 35 may lead to degradation of the nation majority of patients, but may have even worse. Personal situation in few patients. So that's a controversial, but it's helpful for many patients in reduction of the weight and reversing the niche. Liver transplantation is the third most common indication of liver transplantation in the USA. It's NASH and NAFLD and leading to NASH and fibrosis, cirrhosis. So this is the third most common indication of liver transplantation in the United States. The indicated an appropriate candidate with advanced fibrosis called NASH. Liver transplantation for NASH with advanced fibrosis is associated with increased mortality due to cardiovascular disease and sepsis compared with the transplantation for other indications. So, in patients with NASH, already they are at risk for cardiovascular diseases and chronic kidney diseases. In the liver transplant, increased risk than other patients who are going for the liver transplantation for cardiovascular disease and sepsis. Statins, these are lipid lowering agents. Normally, there's the idea that they are metabolism for the liver, so they should not be given, but the studies have shown that they are not contraindicated in this health, but may be protective in some patients to develop NASH. So, for those patients who are taking statins, they should continue. You can prescribe the statins for those patients with NAFLD to reduce the chance of NASH fibrosis. The related disorder, as we discussed here, is non-alcoholic fatty liver disease. So it means alcohol may cause the fatty liver disease, or all the consequences that alcohol is causing, same for the fatty changes will cause the changes to liver. So alcohol-associated liver disease, here you can see the two measurements of alcohol, and the purpose of showing these measurements is that it's not the quantity that's consumed, also the quality is important. Some beverages, some alcohol contains more amount of ethanol, some contain less amount of ethanol. So when we are taking a history from patients and alcohol consumption, it's necessary to get know that what type of alcohol person is consuming and how in how much quantity he or she is taking alcohol for and the duration. So type and duration is important. The most common beverage consumed worldwide, alcohol consumption is a major medical and social problem. It increases morbidity and mortality in many ways, including effect on heart, brain, peripheral nerves, liver, cancer, and psychiatric problems, and many more. It's also associated with nutritional deficiencies and affect metabolism of many indices, but most of these alcoholic beverages, they contain sugar, so you may not find emaciated or nutritional deficient in this patient. They may maintain their normal weight. Metabolism of the ethanol or ethyl alcohol is oxidized to acetaldehyde, and then acetaldehyde is converted to acetate, that is 90% of the liver mitochondria. So its metabolism is major, mainly through the liver, through mitochondria. Acetate is released into blood and oxidized by the peripheral tissues to carbon dioxide and water. Alcohol dehydrogenase is present in many tissues, but the major contribution is by the enzyme present in the gut mucosa. Females have less amount of the alcohol dehydrogenase in their gastric mucosa than males, so alcoholic damage occurs in females at lower quantity than in females, than in males. So less amount of the alcohol may cause more injury, hepatitis, other consequences of alcohol in female genes compared to the male, because of the lower amount of the alcoholic dehydrogenase in female patients, in the gut mucosa of females. Now, the concentration of different alcoholic products and their composition, one unit, helium to 120 ka jata hai, one unit of alcohol is equal to 8 gram of ethanol, that is equal to 10 milliliter of the pure ethanol. So when we see any alcohol beverage, we have to look at the concentration or percentage of ethanol. Then we can decide, we can assume how much quantity of a person is taking. And then 10 ml or one unit of alcohol, 8 gram of ethanol or 10 ml of ethanol is equal to one pint of beer, is around 284 ml, and there is 3.5%. Contain 3.5% ethanol. Commonly people say that beer is non-alcoholic and there is no harm to beer, so it is alcoholic, though it contains less amount of ethanol, but it is an alcohol-containing beverage. And this is equal to half glass of wine that contains 11.4% of the ethanol, around 88 milliliters. So half pint of beer, that's around 284 ml, is equal to 88 ml of wine, is equal to 10 ml of the pure ethanol, that's equal to one single beer, around 25 ml of spirit that contains 40% of ethanol. So sometimes people are using the spirit and the locally made alcohol is, it contains much more quantity of spirit, that sometimes it becomes very toxic to the kidneys and your eyes, brain as well. So it is important to know what type of the ethanol or alcohol person is consuming. So one single measure, around 25 ml of the spirit, it contains 40% of ethanol. And it is again is equal to a glass of the port or sherry, so around 200 ml, that can 17% ethanol, and that is the same amount of the liquid, the 43 ml of the vodka or rum or gin, that can be 40% of the alcohol. So it's important to know that what type of the alcohol person is consuming. Then we can predict the severity of the liver disease or other damage of the organs accordingly. So it's very important to get what type of the, and how much, what the duration. Excessive alcohol intake can lead to fatty liver, hepatitis, fibrosis, and cirrhosis. It can cause acute or chronic hepatitis. So here we are discussing hepatitis, not the cardiac makeup, cardiomyopathy, it may damage the eyes, it may damage the central nervous system, peripheral nervous system, kidney. So we are discussing here as a damage on the liver. It can cause acute or chronic hepatitis. Often alcohol-associated hepatitis is a reversible disease. A person reversible disease in the sense that patient has not developed decompensated liver cirrhosis. When the patient develops decompensated liver cirrhosis, portal vein dilated, there are ascites, there is a history of encephalopathy and silver fibrosis more than stage 3-4, then it becomes irreversible. So earlier, if the person quits this habit, the liver damage is reversible. But when this is the liver damage is beyond certain some limit, then it may become irreversible damage. Alcohol hepatitis is the most common cause of cirrhosis in the USA. So in our countries, in poor countries, hepatitis B, C, Delta, and other disorders are common cause of the cirrhosis. But in the United States, is the most common cause of cirrhosis because the infection causes are very rare in these countries, in developed countries, but very common, the consumption of alcohol is there. Associated with the 4 to 5 times the number of hospitalization and deaths than hepatitis C in the USA and Western world. So, but C ke patient jo yahan Western world mein hospitalized ho rahe hain and death ho rahi hai unse compare kiya jaye hospitalization and death is around alcohol that is 4 to 5 times more common than the viral diseases. Maybe reverse in our country, but we are getting the case of alcoholic hepatitis as well in our country, in poor countries as well. But here, virus has the effect of disease, a common chronic liver disease. Chronic alcohol intake exceeding 80 gram per day in May and 40 gram per day. 40 gram means around about 4 to 5 units, 80 gram per unit of the day. 4 to 5 gram of a unit, around 8. To 10 units in females, 4 to 5 units will be equal to 10 gram and 40 gram respectively. And women for more than 5 years may lead to hepatitis and cirrhosis. So it's important. Person, how the quantity he or she is taking, and we should know the duration. Occasional drinkers may not develop this type of disease, but who are regularly drinkers and consuming in this quantity 4 or 5 units per day in ladies and 8 to 10 units per day for male, and they are at risk to develop cirrhosis if they are consuming this for more than 5 years. It is estimated that 10 to 15% of persons will develop cirrhosis who consume 50 gram of alcohol daily over 10 years. Really, the 50 gram means around 5 to 6 units of alcohol daily they are for 10 years, they are developing that risk to develop cirrhosis. Again, here this is important. The risk of cirrhosis is lower for wine than beer or spirit. So, beer and spirit, we have discussed that beer in particular is lower quantity, and these patients are at risk to develop cirrhosis. The risk of cirrhosis is lower for wine than beer and spirits. The risk is more in alcoholic patients who are obese or suffering from viral hepatitis. So, those patients who are obese, they are the viral hepatitis, they are low consumer alcohol, they are at risk to develop cirrhosis. Genetic factors play an important role. ये क्यों होता है कि 5-10% को या 10-20% को नेफेड हो जाता है, 20-30 को नेफेड हो रहा है, बाकी को नहीं हो रहा, 15% अब वाले को स्लोस हो रहा है, बाकी को नहीं हो रहा, तो जेनेटिक फैक्टर्स आर वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट है। फीमेल पॉपुलेशन इज मोर ससेप्टेबल देन मेल बिकॉज़ द लोअर लेवल ऑफ द अल्कोहोलिक डिहाइड्रेशन इन द इन द गैस्ट्रिक मेकुला यंग मेन हु हैड ड्रिंक एक्सेसिवली आर एट रिस्क ऑफ लिवर डिजीज लेटर इन लाइफ इवन दे हैव क्विट दिस हैबिट आर नॉट ड्रिंकिंग दैट अमाउंट पहले 5-10 साल तक उन्होंने बहुत यूज किया था अल्कोहल नाउ दे हैव क्विट दिस अल्कोहल और दे आर यूजिंग लेस अमाउंट ऑफ दिस अल्कोहल बट लेटर इन लाइफ दे मे डेवलप सिरोसिस एथेनॉल इज मेटाबोलाइज्ड इन द लिवर रिजल्टिंग इन इंक्रीज्ड एनएडीएच एंड एनएडी रेशियो ऑल्सो इंक्रीज्ड हेपेटिक फैटी एसिड सिंथेसिस एंड डिक्रीज्ड ऑक्सीडेशन दिस पैथोजेनेसिस leading to accumulation of fatty acids that will justify to glycerides. The oxidation reduction change will impair carbohydrate and protein metabolism, leading to centrilobular necrosis of hepatic acidosis, a characteristic feature of the alcohol damage. What would be the clinical features in these alcoholic patients? most of the time, except asymptomatic hepatomegaly. Sometimes from asymptomatic hepatomegaly to enuresis, nausea, jaundice, fatal acute or acute on chronic liver disease, decompensated cirrhosis, abdominal pain, tenderness, splenomegaly, ascites, fever, encephalopathy, and infections, particularly aspergillosis is common in alcoholic associated hepatitis. Laboratory findings, most of the patients present with only mild elevation of the liver enzymes, headache or nephral. Macrocytic anemia is common. You may get leukocytosis with the neutrophilia, and this is the blood CP of these patients. Neutropenia sometimes. That results of cessation of drinking sometimes. Usually, leukocytosis with the neutrophilia. Thrombocytopenia will maybe 10% of cases will present with thrombocytopenia, and this thrombocytopenia is usually due to hypersplenism or toxic effect of alcohol and on megaglobulins. AST elevated, but rarely about 300 unit per liter. So the AST to ALT ratio is more than 2 times normal. Usually in other liver disorders, ALT becomes higher than the AST until patient develops fibrosis, severe fibrosis, osteoporosis, but in alcoholic hepatitis, AST becomes higher than the ALT. Serum alkaline phosphate is raised really 3 times of parliament of normal value. Serum bilirubin is raised in 60 to 90% of the cases. Some important findings that may predict the prognosis and severity of the disease. Serum bilirubin more than 10 mg per deciliter or prothrombin time more than 6 seconds or above indicates severe alcohol associated hepatitis. Data has mortality of more than 50%. Serum albumin level usually decreased. Serum gamma globulin, particularly IgA level, will be elevated in more than 50 to 75% alcoholics, even in the absence of cirrhosis. So, gamma globulin level may be higher in these patients without cirrhosis. Transferrin saturation commonly raised in these patients. Hepatic iron esters are decreased, and cytoplastic anemia is commonly found in alcoholic patients. Folic acid deficiency is also common in alcoholics. And we will go for the imaging studies. The ultrasound can detect moderate to severe hepatic steatosis, but is not sensitive to detect inflammation or fibrosis. So sometimes we can need a CT scan, IMRI to need to select the cases to evaluate patients who have small liver vessels, space occupying lesions of liver, or concomitant pancreatic disease. What about liver biopsy? It demonstrates macrovesicular fat, polymorphonuclear neutrophil infiltration with hepatic necrosis, malaroid bodies, and perivenular and perisinusoidal fibrosis. Micronodular cirrhosis may be present in these alcoholic patients. Findings are identical to those of non-alcoholic institutional hepatitis. So that's why that topic is labeled as non-alcoholic, means those patients who are not taking alcohol, these are findings are there. We are labeling them as non-alcoholic in those patients who are alcoholic. So almost 5 findings are same. So we label them alcohol-associated hepatitis. How to manage? The main supplement is abstinence from alcohol. Advise them to quit the service. First of all, and most important and cost-effective management is to quit the habit. And proper caloric diet, nutritional support in anorexic digestive patient, micronutrients sometimes are needed, like folic acid, thiamine, and zinc deficiency. They are very common in alcoholic patients, so they should be replenished. Avoidance of hepatotoxic and nephrotoxic drugs. So here are some treatment options for these patients who develop cirrhosis and severe fibrosis with alcohol. In earlier stage, usually the management is only to quit the smoking and caloric diet and replacement of the deficient nutrients. In severe disease, when there is severe fibrosis or decompensation, protein down is raised, and patient going in encephalopathy or other consequences of the chronic liver disease that we will discuss in coming lectures. Methylprednisolone, corticosteroids, 35 milligrams per day orally for 1 month may reduce short-term mortality in alcoholic patients such as encephalopathy, but for long-term mortality, it has no good effect. Much of it for the long-term mortality, only short-term mortality. The combination of corticosteroids with acetylcysteine further improves short-term mortality with reduction of risk of hepatorenal syndrome and infections. So, sometimes acetylcysteine is combined with the corticosteroids. It may be helpful. Again, it will be helpful to reduce the short-term mortality. Pentoxifilin, sorry for spelling mistake. Pentoxifilin 400 mg orally 3 times a day for 4 weeks decrease the risk of hepatorenal syndrome. And thank you. That's about today's journey. Any question? You are welcome here. And unmute you all and you can ask any question. Excuse me. Unmute.
Unmute, yes.
So many questions. Okay.